We are so, so delighted to have a very special person with us today. And I just want to say a very brief word about a very special man. And that would be Wilmot James. When this morning you heard Brad Smith say that there were trustees who raised questions about this program and who were determined that this would be a great program. Wilmot James led that charge. It was Wilmot who spoke authentically of what this program needed to be and helped the foundation create an aspiration and a vision for IFP. You all know Wilmot because he is a passionate patriot and man of justice, a great humanitarian who was on the front of change and a time and a place and a country that many of us could not imagine. And he emerged victorious. He and his country emerged victorious. And today he is making us proud in the parliament, representing and chairing the DA, and doing work that lifts us up and helps us to keep the dream alive and to live it every day as you do. Wilmot James, please come up, and everyone, give a huge, huge welcome to Wilmot James.
Thank you very much, and good afternoon, everybody. I must tell you that I'm delighted to stand here. I was a member of the board of Ford from 1996 to 2008, so 12 years long, and I've been back once, and so I'm absolutely delighted to be here and to see my family again. I'd like to thank Joan Dasseton and Don McGendry for inviting me. Thank you very much. Now, when I first received the invitation, Joan asked me to write an abstract of my talk, and I did, and you'll see the abstract in the booklet. But when I sat down to write what I'm going to share with you today, I was worrying about three things. The first was a question about what the evidence is of returns to education in terms of access to jobs and income, under circumstances where there's a lot of skepticism about what value education adds to opportunities and to life chances. So that's the first issue that worried me. But the second one was an issue of distributional justice. We trade places with Brazil for being the most unequal countries in the world. And inequality is normally measured by an algorithm called the Gini coefficient, which measures the distance between the least well-off compared to the best, most well-off. And we trade places. So we're a highly unequal country, South Africa. And we live in a place where about 2.8 million young South Africans between the ages of 19 and 24 are not in educational institutions nor have a job. The acronym for that is NEET. Not in education and not in employment. It's not a status you wish on anybody. So I was worrying about the issue of distributional justice. And I thought about John Rawls's theory of justice, where he had framed what's known as two original propositions. The first one is that we all have the same rights, except those rights that infringe on the rights of others. That's the first position. And the second position that he advocates is that social policies must benefit the least advantaged the most. And that is a test for how progressive social policies must be. And the third issue I worried about was about the access those who have education, what access do they have to employment opportunities, and how do we understand the architecture of the barriers that prevent people from getting jobs, young people from getting jobs. So this is what I wrote. When studying its long and rich history of groundmaking, the 1990s leadership of the Ford Foundation learned that the one investment that brought the greatest returns, obvious perhaps by hindsight, but in a context of considerable cynicism, was education. You heard this morning that the designers of the IFP were convinced that earlier graduate fellowships, which at the time supported leaders such as Kofi Annan, were worthy contributions to advancing human welfare, which if you ask anybody to look at Ford's documents and ask what is his mission, it's a very simple two-word, three-word phrase, which is to advance human welfare. This was therefore a visionary investment. And at the time of the launch in Washington, D.C., Senator Richard Lugar observed at the program launch, which was in November of 2000, that the IFP creatively brought together human talent in the fields of politics, economics, and education in service of ethical leadership devoted to public service. Beyond the considerable quantum of money involved of this investment, the eligibility criteria were as creative as they were revealing of donor intent. We were looking at individuals who excelled academically, who had the potential to excel academically, showed evidence of leadership potential, and indicated an inclination towards public service. Now, this concept has very deep roots in North American history. Just over 70 years ago, President Franklin Roosevelt delivered his very famous Four Freedoms speech. At the time, he was preparing the American public for the reality of war. And explaining the rationale for U.S. involvement, he built his argument on four pillars that he saw as essential for a just world. Now, it is easy to see how the first three, freedom of expression, freedom to worship, and freedom from fear, must have resonated at a time when totalitarian dictatorships were on the march. Regarding the fourth freedom, let me argue that freedom from want. In his most recent book, Sam Harris, in a book titled The Moral Landscape, which is an extraordinary book, he speaks of freedom from misery, which is the same thing. The freedom from want and freedom from misery is every bit as pressing today as it was in the 1940s when Roosevelt spoke. Now, of course, everyone knows that the Great Recession of 2008-2009 has resulted in widespread hardship everywhere, both in the rich and the developing world. Close to 1 million jobs are lost in my home country, South Africa, alone. But the truth is, inequality has been rising across the world for some time now. Even as wealth has been created in many emerging economies, including many in Africa, as a consequence of what some have termed the rise of the rest, the distribution of opportunity generated by growth over the past few decades has been anything but fair, anything but passing the Rawls original proposition. During the period of deregulation between the 1980s and the booming 2000s, for example, the Gini coefficient, to which I referred, in the United States increased from 0.34 to 0.38, where one is perfect inequality and zero is perfect equality. In China, it increased to 0.4 during the same period, and it has increased ever since. However, when discussing the impact of inequality on access to opportunity, it is very important to differentiate between inequality that is the product of runaway economic growth as opposed to inequality that is caused by adverse government policies and what has been described as non-inclusive political institutions. So inequality continues to climb in the People's Republic of China, but in this instance, it is a product of immense wealth production disproportionately benefiting a well-connected elite as part of a wider process of growth. Even at the bottom rungs of the employment ladder, incomes have risen dramatically and continue to do so. In many other parts of the world, including my own country, South Africa, where growth is slowed or is even flatlining, inequality is not simply the consequence of the rich getting richer faster than anyone else. Rather, it is a systemic problem that is underpinned by policies that undermine fairness and equality of opportunity, the very antithesis of the reconciliation between liberty and inequality explained in John Rawls's theory of justice. For the world's poor, and particularly the young, this is not an esoteric question. Its consequences directly impact on their material well-being. In a recent report, The Economist warns of a jobless generation caused by the economic slowdown in the West, rapid population growth, inadequate education, and dysfunctional labor markets, particularly in countries such as India and Egypt, and I would add South Africa as well. According to the OECD globally, the number of young people without a job has risen by 30% since 2007, with around 262 million young people in emerging markets economically inactive. That's according to World Bank figures. The report describes an arc of unemployment stretching from Southern Europe through North Africa and the Middle East to South Asia. In South Africa, youth unemployment stands at over 50%. The figure is closer to 60% if you are black and if you are female. The relationship between income and educational attainment has been very well documented. According to the US Labor Bureau of Statistics, for example, the figures show that people graduating with a professional degree earn, on average, three times that of someone with a high school diploma and more than four times that of someone who didn't graduate from high school. A recent study called the College Payoff, conducted by Georgetown University scholars, states that the difference between those who go to college and those who don't is growing, meaning that post-secondary education is more important than ever. The challenge, my friends, then, is for governments to find ways to expand access to higher education while ensuring that the skills imparted by the education system provides young people with the capabilities they need to compete in an increasingly exacting, knowledge-driven economy. But expanding access to education means something more profound than simply impacting on the incomes and earning power of future graduates. By enabling young people to realize their potential and broaden their horizons, post-secondary education is essential for helping them to unlock what Amartya Sen refers to in his book titled Development as Freedom as the capabilities to lead the lives we value. In Sen's view, this freedom to use one's capabilities to become an agent for change is both the primary end and the principal means of development. It is the premise upon which the International Fellowships Program rests. The philosopher A.C. Grayling goes further when he says that, and I quote, education, and especially liberal education, has an importance even greater than its contribution to economic success, which, alas, is all that politicians seem to think it is for. He makes the following points. Firstly, education that includes literature, history, science, and appreciation of the arts open the possibility to live more knowledgeably and more reflectively, built as it is on studying a range of human experiences and human sentiments. Secondly, such education has us better understand the interests, the needs, and the desires of others. So we can treat individuals of diverse backgrounds with respect and with sympathy, however different the choices they may make or the experiences that have shaped their lives. And finally, when as a result of this kind of education, respect and sympathy is returned, rendering the emotional connection between individuals reciprocal and mutual, the result can be to bridge the gaps of friction and even attenuate the possibilities of war, fanciful as it may sound. He goes on to talk about how training and education differs. Young children, he says, need to be trained in multiplication tables, reading, spelling, and writing through coaching, repetition, and practice. Once these skills are available by reflex, children command the confidence to go to the next level, which is the process to think and to know where to find relevant information. Above all, education involves refining capacities for judgment and for evaluation. It was Heraclitus who once remarked that learning is only a means to an end, and that end is understanding, and understanding is education's ultimate value. And so I end with a note of congratulations to say how much we admire the young leaders who benefited from the IFB fellowships, as much as all of us wish to express our gratitude publicly to Joan, Dasson, and her team, the global team, and the IFB board led by the esteemed Don McHenry for making this possible. Susan Beresford, Brad Smith, Alison Burns, there's always a risk that you leave somebody out, and I don't want to leave anybody out, to say that all the other members of the Force professional staff, who I know because I was there, were focused on this issue, as I've never seen people focus. Fully supported by the board, were the authors of this extraordinary program. But my friends, our work is not yet over. We must act now to reduce the barriers limiting young people's participation in the economy and implement policies that will enable the next generation to realize their potential and become public leaders committed to a fairer and more just world. Thank you very much.